Welcome back to Catalyst University. My name is Kevin Tokoff. Please make sure to like this video and subscribe to my channel for future videos and notifications. And a big thank you to my patrons on Patreon for your contributions to my channel. In this video, we're going to be talking extensively about the shoulder girdle muscles. We're going to first learn what they are, and then we're going to look at each muscle and explore its structure, its origin, insertion, action, and innervation, and other important features of them. Now, before we get into all the muscles here, we need to first understand what is a shoulder girdle muscle. So do shoulder girdle muscles actually move the true shoulder joint? No, they don't. Shoulder girdle muscles actually produce movements of the scapula. They don't actually move the shoulder joint. And when I say the shoulder joint, what I'm really referring to is the glenohumeral joint. So this is from the previous video where we talked about pectoralis major. And if we zoom in right here, we can actually see the true shoulder joint. This is the glenohumeral joint. It's a joint between the head of the humerus and the glenoid fossa of the scapula. And so this muscle, for example, can move the glenohumeral joint because it's able to attach on the humerus. And so by pulling on the humerus, it moves the glenohumeral joint in specific movements like extension or flexion, things like that. Okay? When we start talking about the shoulder girdle muscles, we're no longer talking about movements of the shoulder joint. We're talking about movements of the scapula. So none of these muscles are actually going to insert on the humerus. They're all going to insert on the scapula, and they're going to pull on the scapula and move the scapula. That is what a shoulder girdle muscle does. Let's start by looking at the trapezius. The trapezius here is a very large muscle that has three components. It has an upper part, which is called the upper trapezius, a middle part, the middle trapezius, and a lower part, which is the lower trapezius, okay? Now, depending on what part of the trapezius we're talking about, upper, middle, or lower, they all have different origins. So if we look at the upper trapezius, it actually has four origins. Two, I think, got cut off here. So up top on the cranium, specifically on the occiput, there's actually two. There's this superior nuchal line right here, and then this bump kind of in the midline called the external occipital protuberance. Okay? Those are two of them. And then coming down here, we actually have the spinous processes of C1 through C7, which you can't see. And then also there's a ligament that connects those spinous processes called the nuchal ligament or ligamentum nuchae. Okay, so those four things comprise the upper trapezius' origin. Now the insertion of the upper trapezius is going to be the lateral third of the clavicle. We obviously can't see the clavicle here because the clavicle is more anterior, but the fibers are going to kind of project down and laterally, and they're going to insert on the lateral third of the clavicle. Now if you think about the projection of the muscle fibers from origin to insertion, do the fibers go out up or do they go out down? Well, if they start at the origin and kind of go this way, they're actually descending downward. And so sometimes the upper trapezius, they like to be tricky, is also referred to as the descending part or descending fibers. Because if you look at it from origin to insertion, the fibers actually descend downward toward that insertion. Okay? Next, let's look at the middle trapezius. So this is the region of the trapezius between these dotted lines and these right here. Now the middle trapezius also has several origins, very broad muscle. So also a little bit up here at the nuchal ligament around C7, but really then the spinous processes and the supraspinous ligaments between the levels of about C7 down through about T3. So right in this area, this is going to be your middle trapezius. And the insertion of the middle trapezius is really the medial part of the acromial process and the superior crest of the scapular spine. So here's a posterior view, obviously, and here's the scapula. So right here, this is the spine of the scapula, and as you go laterally, the spine actually becomes continuous with this projection right here called the acromial process. And so if you look at the insertion of the trapezius, it's the acromial process, and then the superior part of that scapular spine, okay? Now, if you look at these muscle fibers, they really don't go up or down to any significant extent. They kind of go out laterally. And so the middle trapezius is often said to have the horizontal fibers, okay, or transverse fibers because they're just going out laterally. Then we look at the lower trapezius beneath these dotted lines right here. Here's the lower trapezius. The lower trapezius originates from the spinous processes and supraspinous ligaments from T4 all the way down to T12. You'll notice that the trapezius exists all the way from the skull and the C-spine, but it doesn't actually originate off of anything in the lumbar spine, so it terminates really at T12. You can remember that T for trapezius does not go into the lumbar spine and terminates at the last thoracic vertebrae, T12, TNT. Now, the insertion of the lower trapezius is really going to be on the medial end of the scapular spine, so kind of in this area right there, medial end of the scapular spine, that's where the lower trapezius inserts. And if we look at the fibers of the lower trapezius from the origin to the insertion, they're ascending upwards. So the lower fibers are often called the ascending fibers of the trapezius. Now, depending on which region of the trapezius we're talking about, each one has different actions. We'll start with the lower trapezius down here. Lower trapezius facilitates what we call scapulothoracic inferomedial glide. Let's break that down. So the scapulothoracic refers to the fact that there's an articulation between the scapula and the ribs. Ribs are only in the thoracic region, right? There's ribs coming off of T1 down through T12, right? So really the scapula just kind of glides over the posterior aspect of the ribs. And that articulation, it's a loose articulation, but it's the scapulothoracic joint, okay? And then the lower trapezius is able to pull in both the downward direction and the medial direction. Okay, if you look at the orientation of these fibers, they kind of go diagonally down, but there's a little bit of medial pull and there's a lot of inferior pull. So it's more of an inferomedial glide. So it's really more inferior, and so for that reason, we usually term what the lower fibers do as scapular depression. Okay, so the scapula can do many things. It can glide upwards, that would be elevation. And it can glide downwards, that would be depression. And so when we talk about this inferomedial glide, we're really talking about scapular depression, and that's the job of the lower trapezius, okay? In terms of the middle fibers of trapezius, well, you can imagine they're gonna pull the insertion towards the origin, so they're gonna tend to wanna pull the scapula medially. So they're gonna facilitate what we call scapular retraction. So this picture is showing the movement of the scapula laterally. That would be protraction, and movement medially is retraction. These are kind of in reverse order up here, but moving medially is retraction. So the middle fibers are gonna pull the scapula toward the midline, and that's called scapular retraction. And we could really be specific and say scapulothoracic medial glide. Now, the upper fibers of trapezius have the most function. In terms of the scapula, they facilitate scapulothoracic supromedial glide. Okay. You can see there's a little bit of medial pull, but in general, the fibers really run upwards. And so the upper traps, upper trapezius, are going to elevate the scapula and pull it upward. Okay. Now they also do a number of things at the neck, okay, by virtue that they also attach at the occiput up here. So they're going to facilitate what we call atlanto-occipital joint extension. So the atlanto-occipital joint is the joint between the occiput and the C1 cervical vertebrae. So these can actually facilitate extension at that joint by pulling bilaterally, both the right upper trapezius and the left upper trapezius. So basically when you tilt your head back to look up at the ceiling, that is in part facilitated by the upper trapezius. Also, we can facilitate cervical lateral flexion or side bending. So basically, if you put your left ear down to your left shoulder, so bend your head to the left, that would be the left upper trapezius, because notice that's an ipsilateral pull. But at the atlanto-axial joint, so the joint between C1 and C2, we can facilitate contralateral rotation. So in other words, if I wanted to rotate my head to the right, that would actually be the left upper trapezius. So rotation is actually a contralateral movement, but side bending is ipsilateral in terms of which upper trap is contributing, okay? The other thing to notice about the upper and lower traps is they also participate in rotation of the scapula. We're going to talk about this at the very end, so anytime we have a rotation, we'll just hold off to the last minute of the video. But it suffices to say now that the upper and lower trapezius both facilitate upward rotation of the scapula. The middle trapezius is the only shoulder girdle muscle that does not facilitate any rotation. This is only a scapular retractor. So hopefully that makes sense. Now let's move on and talk about pectoralis minor. So this is a very small convergent muscle that's directly deep to pectoralis major. So if we go back up and take a look at that muscle, here's pectoralis major. Pectoralis minor lies directly deep to it, kind of in this region right there. So pectoralis minor has an origin really on ribs 3 through 5. So if you look, here's rib number 1, here's rib 2, and then you see ribs 3, 4, and 5. That's the origin of this muscle. And it's really at the costochondral junction. So kind of here where the costal cartilage ends and the bony part of the rib begins, that's really where it's attaching. And it converges up here to insert right here on the coracoid process. Now, of course, this is an anterior view of the scapula because we can see the sternum right here, right? So you'll notice that it actually attaches on the anterior part of the coracoid process. Now, the action of this muscle is mainly as a scapular stabilizer. So it's able to kind of pull on this coracoid process, which helps to stabilize the scapula against the rib cage. Okay? This is important during inhalation, but it's also important during a lot of other activities. It's also worth mentioning that the pectoralis minor can also facilitate a little bit of protraction. So protraction is movement of the scapula away from the midline. So this arrow going to the right there, that's protraction. The pectoralis minor can do that a little bit. Now it's innervated by the medial pectoral nerve, and what you should notice is that the pectoralis major is innervated by both the medial and lateral pectoral nerves, whereas the pectoralis minor is only medial. Now, yes, I mentioned the pectoralis minor participates in both scapular stabilization and scapular protraction. However, the major muscle for both of those actions is really this one, the serratus anterior. The serratus anterior is named as such is because if you took a large steak knife and really zoomed in on the serrated edge of the steak knife, you'd see these little spikes that come out, right? And that's what actually helps to cut through a steak, right? And so the serratus anterior kind of has that appearance, and so for that reason it's termed the serratus anterior. So the origin of the serratus anterior is really more anterior. These are actually the origins over here, and it's really the superior 8 or 9 ribs. So let's see in this picture, it'd be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So we've got all 9 ribs here. And then each component here of the serratus anterior projects posteriorly to attach on the medial border of the scapula, particularly its costal aspect. Costal aspect means it's the side of the medial border that's actually in contact with the ribs. Okay, so that's the insertion of serratus anterior. Now, the serratus anterior is a very important scapular protractor. So yes, the pectoralis minor can help with that, but the serratus anterior is really the major scapular protractor. Okay, as we'll talk about at the end, it also participates in a little bit of upward rotation, and it's also very important for stabilizing the scapula against the rib cage. Now, there's a really important implication of serratus anterior weakness. So what you see over here is what we call scapular winging. So when this person goes into scapular protraction, on one side, the scapula is normal. That's his left side. This is what we would expect to see. But on the right side, there's an obvious bulging of the scapula. And the main cause of this is a lesion of the long thoracic nerve. I got it covered up there. But that long thoracic nerve is what innervates the serratus anterior. If there's long thoracic nerve damage, then the serratus anterior's function is going to be compromised. Remember, one of its functions is to stabilize the scapula against the rib cage. Well, if this nerve is lesioned or damaged, and the serratus anterior as a result is weak, it's not going to be able to hold the scapula against the rib cage, and so it's going to bulge out backwards. And so that's what you see here. And so if you ever see scapular winging, the most likely diagnosis is a lesion of the long thoracic nerve, or there is a possibility it could be just severe muscle weakness of the serratus anterior. But that's scapular winging. Next, let's look at levator scapulae. That's this muscle right here. Now, levator scapulae, based on the name, it should levitate, so elevate, the scapula, and that's exactly what we see. So its origin is up here on the transverse processes of C1, C2, C3, and C4. It also does have an origin on the C1 posterior tubercle as well, which you can't really see right here too well. The insertion is down here on the superomedial border of the scapula. So on the medial border, but the superior part of it. The major action, as we said, of the levator scapulae is to elevate the scapula. So it's able to pull on the scapula and move it upward, just like upper trapezius. It's also going to participate in downward rotation. Now, there are three major muscles that are innervated by the dorsal scapular nerve. One of them is levator scapulae. The other two are the rhomboids, rhomboids minor and rhomboids major. So here's the rhomboids right here. And there's actually two of them. The more superior one is the smaller rhomboid minor. The larger one is the inferior rhomboid major. Let's first talk about the rhomboid major. Its origins are really on the spinous processes of T2 down through T5. Okay? And you can see that it's going to project laterally to insert right here on the scapula, really at the medial border of the scapula. Okay. Up here we have the rhomboid minor. Its origins are really going to be the spinous processes of C7 down through T1, but also a little bit on the nuchal ligament, which terminates at C7. So kind of right up here would be the end of the nuchal ligament, and this would be the origin of the rhomboid minor. Fibers project out laterally and insert on the medial border of the scapula as well. But the big distinction here is that because the rhomboid major is the inferior muscle, it's going to have the more inferior insertion. Rhomboid minor is the more superior of the two. It's going to have the more superior insertion on the medial border of the scapula. And like the levator scapulae, the two rhomboids here are both innervated by the dorsal scapular nerve. The action of the rhomboids collectively, both major and minor, is going to be to facilitate scapular retraction, so pulling that scapula back toward the midline. They also participate in a little bit of downward rotation. Now, on the topic of scapular rotation, we have both upward rotation and downward rotation. And I go into this in a lot more detail in another video, so make sure to check that out. But here's the basic idea. Whenever we have upward rotation of the scapula, it really just angles the glenoid fossa more up, okay? If we have downward rotation, it angles the glenoid fossa more down. So that's how you know if it's upward or downward rotating. If the glenoid fossa is more up, it's upward. If the glenoid fossa is more down, it's downward. And there are three major upward rotators of the scapula. Those are the upper trapezius, the lower trapezius, and the serratus anterior. Remember that the middle trapezius is only a scapular retractor, so it participates zero in rotation of the scapula. So the upward rotator is the upper and lower traps and serratus anterior. That leaves all the others as downward rotators, and those are going to be the rhomboids, both minor and major, levator scapulae, and pectoralis minor. Now in reality, pectoralis minor is kind of a distant third there. It's very minor. Okay, the major two, or three I should say, are the rhomboids and levator scapulae for downward rotation. Thanks for tuning in. Please like, subscribe, and check out my Instagram for cool science and not science stuff. And a big thank you to my patrons on Patreon for your contributions to my channel.